Welcome back to the 24 hours of Spa-Francorchamps, supported by Blue Flag Racing here on Simrace.TV. It is late in the evening, early in the morning, and late afternoon, early evening here in America. It is the 10th of January 2015. John Palmer and Phil Diaz with you. It has been an action-packed race so far. X-Racing Red currently leading. Team Redline by almost a minute. GT Ross SST Silver in third, minute 12 behind. Phil, it has been an up and down race so far for Team Redline.
Yeah, they've had a couple issues, a little bit of damage from a lapped car earlier, and then once that was repaired, they had a huge moment with Ollie Pacula, who's currently in the car, where they ended up doing a 360 out of Blanchemont, and I still can't believe that happened. No damage. Amazing.
There is a protest pending against car number 99 from car number 128, car 99 being NX Red, car 128 being Team Turkey Motorsport. There was an incident at Les Combes on car 128's lap 127 contact there at Les Combes. Edmonds, Mike Booth, and Joe Littoriello in the process of reviewing that. And of course also tracking all the off tracks at varying sections. Of course, and dealing with all the other issues coming up through the race.
Yeah, I actually think we're going to have a penalty here in a second for the number 90 car, who's had way too many off tracks at Blanchemont. So they're about to receive a penalty, if they have not already.
Yep. And also, big thanks to everyone for staying with us. Don't forget, a couple ways to get in contact with us through social media. If you're watching the stream on mastersofendurance.net/live, you can get to us on IRC. Channel is MOE on the Game Search Network. Tweet us! Use hashtag IRM. Follow us at mastersofendurance. If you're staying up all 24 hours like me and Phil are, show us a picture of your rig. If you're going to sit in front of your computer all 24 hours, if you've got a small refrigerator or something with you, show us your setup. If you've got a whole big setup, even if you're not staying up all 24 hours, share that with us. And of course, any questions you have, if you want to ask a question about the strategy, what's happened to the team, tweet us. We'll get you an answer on the stream. And also facebook.com/Masters of Endurance. Like us there, we'll give you a couple updates throughout the race on there. Give a quick plug of all of our sponsors. As I said, this is the 24 Hours of Spa for Crump, supported by Blue Flag Racing. Blue Flag Racing. You can find them at facebook.com/Blue Flag Racing. Also, IGP Manager, IGPManager.com. We'll have about 20 some odd more codes to give out for a free year of the 2E viewer, which I think it's about a 20 pound value now. Price recently reduced. Also, I'd like to thank Derek Spear Design, providing 6 track bosses to vary championship placers, top 3 getting a track boss. Also, I think 1 for driver with the lowest incidents after having driven a certain amount of time. Also, just someone who's driven a lot.
Yeah, it's just basically kind of clean driver awards, people who are just participating in MOE. Simple as that.
Yep. And also, IGP is also offering a free subscription to second place in the championship. And also some monetary prizes coming from Blue Flag Racing this round. Also, GrandPrix247.com giving out financial prizes for the race placement at Circuit of the Americas next round. The 6 hours there, and also to the end of the season, top championship finish. Four big sponsors helping us this season on MOE. Phil, tell us what we're watching.
Well, currently, I just realized I didn't have the battles overlay up. You see Klaus Kipkus and Koana Simsport currently pressuring Glacier Racing's Riku Alatalo. 4GT versus BMW. Currently we've seen, we saw the Glacier Racing 4GT, I don't want to say hold up, but basically hold on to the 6th or 5th position for a while now, holding off Paul Ehrlich. However, Paul Ehrlich has pulled ahead of Glacier Racing and is now over 4 seconds ahead. So I think it's just really hard to pass the Ford. I think the straight line speed's a little off. By off, I mean it's much faster than the other cars. So, and they probably have minimum rear wing as well. So it's just, you know, other teams are struggling to overtake them, which, you know, that's an advantage of that of their car. Klaus Kubikus, though, not really bothered by it. He goes and makes the easy pass. Next up, though, for Glacier Racing is Core Motorsports. They are catching as well.
The current driver in the car there, Danny Chiusa. Do you have that picture on there? With his, I think they're Sparco racing gloves on, getting ready to get in the car for the night shift. I race, of course, without day-night-day transitions as yet. Oh, it's getting pretty dark out there right now. There is a night version of Spa, but you don't want that for 24 hours.
Yeah, it's one or the other. We're not going to be switching in between. It's already rough enough trying to take care of 60 cars gridding properly.
Well, and I think, didn't you say, Phil, that you gave me a kind of review of TeamSpeak right after the Spa night came out. What did you say about it?
It was dark. But, I mean, you can see, but I don't know. I think from different perspectives, I think it's better just to have the day race. And if, obviously, if we had the opportunity to switch between day and night, great. Do it, you know, all day long. That's fine. However, I think it's better to just do it all in the daytime simply because, you know, when do you ever see 24 hours a night? Maybe in, like, Alaska, maybe. But, or Antarctica. However, it's just, I don't know. It's too dark for a full 24 hours. You can't really see sometimes when you're coming around corners, people are spinning and whatnot. Obviously, with 60 headlights, though, it would pretty much be just like daytime. But I don't know. There's just a lot of factors that come into play. I don't think, you know, having Spa night like that is a very good idea.
Yep, if you give me a minute, I'll look at sunrise and sunset times for, let's see, how close is Russ?
I think the best thing to do right now for most drivers is they just reach forward and just turn down the brightness of their monitor, or if they have to go in some settings or whatever, just do that, turn down your monitor brightness, and, you know, you're pretty much at night now.
For the record, though, if we did have day-night day, our race time is basically real time of day. Sunset today in Brussels, Belgium was 4:58 p.m. local time. And then we're rising Sunday morning at 8:42 a.m. So therefore giving quite a long nighttime period. As happens when it's wintertime in the Northern Hemisphere.
Yep.
That's one of the big things people always talk about with the Rolex 24 Daytona versus the Le Mans 24 hours. Daytona, being in wintertime, has a long nighttime period. Le Mans, being in the early part of summer, has a very short nighttime period.
Just saw on stream that I didn't want to cut you off, is Glacier Racing's Riku Alatalo just had a slowdown penalty. Pretty obvious there when he started slowing down. Just let Core Motorsports by, and also a lapped car, Last Lap Motorsports.
Yeah, just looking back at that at the top of, at Radeon, little one of those possibly questionable slowdown warnings.
Yeah, it's one of those situations you really don't want to risk it. I mean, if you have all four tires on the curb, that's probably perfectly okay. You probably won't have any, you know, lag issue there. It's just if you have your left side tires on the left side of the curve, then it gets a little pushy.
Yeah, it's pretty quickly after the start of the race, the admin started getting quite a lot of messages from teams saying they were getting black flags, slowdowns. Team Redline being the first we heard from. And the thing with Redline was they had actually slowed down, but iRacing still gave them a black flag.
Yeah, I saw that they had slowed down like 4 seconds or so, but then for some odd reason, we saw that their slowdown didn't actually end. It just kept going. So it might have been some form of issue on iRacing side, not really sure. But I remember they had a 7 second gap and it went down to 3 or so. So as we're actually watching, we see Matthew Hill. He's going to be popping all up on the off-track applications. He just had 3 off-tracks in 3 of our sectors. Currently see JCL Simracing currently trying to hunt down Team TTL. JCL Simracing actually had a really good battle last race. I believe it was for the 10th position, and I think they ended up finishing 11th. I want to say it was with Team Kamara. Having a little bit of brain fade right now, but I believe that's what it was at Suzuka. And that was a good 20 to 30 lap battle. Those guys door to door, even a little door rubbing. And for both of them coming in clean, and both of them actually thanking each other for clean, hard and clean racing after the race, which was very cool to see.
Yep. Yeah, just noticed the gap fairly close looking at live timing. Both drivers about 22, 23 laps since their last pit stop. TTL 22 laps and JCL 24 laps, so fairly close on the pit cycles. Current driver for JCL Simracing in that BMW Z4, Alain Tesler. And once I find his car, Tessier has run 50 laps and is part of the 3 drivers so far for JCL Simracing. He's doing fairly equal duty.
Yeah, you currently see just behind them a car that doesn't have nowhere near the amount of tire, or has much more tire life, I guess you could say, the number 77 car, McLaren in the background there. And he keeps sticking his nose in, but he knows that he shouldn't try and overtake them. These two cars are battling for position, even though they're not that close. So, let's see what happens.
The McLaren MP4 12C chasing is Tuomas Halonen for KRT Motorsport 97. Laps down to this battle between JCL and Team TTL.
To not see these guys get any closer. However, we are seeing, TTL made a little bit of a bobble there. We are seeing a common face making his way through the field. And that is the Cohen SimSport car, driven by Klaus Kiebikus, now catching Paul Elbrink, Radicals Online 2.
I have another guest joining us here in the commentary box. Jura Seelen from Benelux region, just out of the Phoenix Motorsports number 79 car. A car hanging out in 32nd position coming through Pujon now. See? So, Joris, welcome to the commentary box. How was your stint?
I had a very good stint. I overtook some cars at a very good pace. It was very fun to drive, actually.
How do you feel about the race so far? About 6 hours in, well past 6 hours in. Has everything been going okay for you guys, or have there been some problems?
The first few hours were very hectic. The field was bunched up. We also made a mistake ourselves because our driver missed our pit stall and the other involuntary. We had a drive-through actually because of that. Everything else went very fine, so we're doing good.
Now, I might be mistaken, but didn't you guys also have a moment in Blanchimont as well?
Yeah, true. That was just before that incident. So we had a spin at Blanchimont. We were very lucky to keep the car out of the wall, so we didn't have any damage. We just could just resume our race, so no problem.
Okay, good. You guys, 31st position, as you say, you've pretty much given yourself a drive-through and whatnot. What's your kind of goal, what position you want to reach at the end of the race?
Yeah, of course. The first goal of the 24-hour race is to finish the race. Anything else is just a bonus. But if you look at our pace at the moment, I'm sure top 20 should be possible.
I currently see Andre just did a 19 last lap, and no team all the way up until 5th place actually has done a 19 last lap. So, one team. Pure Racing team did one, and they're currently in the 23rd position. So yeah, you guys have pretty good pace right now.
Yeah, we just have to try to keep it up, keep concentrated, stay out of trouble, and it will work out nice, I think.
How's it been so far with traffic? Not just this race, but you know, previous races. Has it been all right? I know there's 60 cars all in one class. We were talking about that earlier. Could you know raise some problems? How's it been for you guys?
We had some problems in previous races, but that was just because the performance of the cars are not very similar. They have their own weaknesses and strong points, so it's difficult to cooperate with each other. And that's probably the most problematic about this setup of cars. But for us, this race is very fine, but previous race was a bit less.
Yeah, I see you guys have the McLaren. We just talked to Dom Duhon from Team Redline, also McLaren. Just that car, it qualifies really well, and the start pace is really well. It just seems like it really dies that last bit of the stint. I feel like the front tires maybe wore off, and then also the rear end gets a little snappy. I don't know if you guys have found ways of maybe in the setup to fix that, or is that just something that happens with the car?
Yeah, we couldn't solve it, so we are just handling it at the moment. We are a bit more cautious at the end of the stint. We managed to do a bit with the tires, but not too much. It's a bit more predictable now. Yeah, we have to just cope with it and keep our concentration up during the whole race. It should not be a problem, actually.
Good to hear.
So you looking for Dakota or Bathurst in the last two rounds of the season?
Yeah, and we know that Dakota is not the most favorite track of all people. I had some very good experiences there, other people don't, so it's a very difficult track to learn because it's very wide, you don't have any reference points. But at the same time, the racing line is very narrow, so you have to keep it on the track all the time. And also because of those yellow triangles at the apexes, it's not, yeah, it's difficult to race there. Bathurst on the other side is a very fun track to drive, but it's very, very unforgiving. If you make one mistake, you're immediately over. So I think both tracks have their charms. I hope we can get good results there as well.
Alrighty. Any team website you'd like to plug, or you know, Facebook, Twitter, etc.?
Yeah, sure. We have a team website. It's called phoenixmotorsports.eu, and at Twitter you can be followed at phoenixmsports. I'll post it to you so you can give it through.
Alrighty, well, we'll wish you luck. When are you back in the car next, Joris?
Probably in 4 hours, so we have 3 drivers, we are just rotating 2 hours each.
Gonna try and get some kip between now and then.
Yeah, something to eat, a bit of rest, and then I'll jump in after 4 hours.
All right, yours. Good luck to you and the rest of your team.
Good luck to you guys.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Yes, sir. Andre Martin's in the car right now for Phoenix Motorsport. Be in position 30.
Yeah, during the interview here, we saw NX Racing Red, Lauren Patel not in the car, which I hope I did not ruin that. And also a pit stop for Team Redline. Ali Apocalypse still driving.
And don't forget, we are uploading the stream parts as quickly as we can after the break, so you can watch things and we don't have to spend 18 hours uploading clips after the race. We do want to thank Lutz Anger at Simrace.TV for all the help he gives for not just MOE but all the other times we've used Simrace.TV in the past for all series, not just Masters of Endurance this season, but other series. The great and most importantly, free streaming platform. You like free, don't you?
I love free. Free is a very nice thing. I'm sure some of these teams agree with there being no entry fee into the series. Kind of like the free aspect of it. As just interrupting myself to say that Glacier Racing, 4GT, just entered the pits there. To do their pit stop, you see the Radicals Online 2 car just behind. Par Elbrink now out of the car.
I think the way you pronounce that name, Phil, is Jerry Witok.
Witok. Yeah, sounds like it. I'm not
if
sure.
If anyone for Radicals is watching, newsweek.newdimensionracing.com or at Masters of Endurance, please tell us how to pronounce his name.
Yeah, we always like any help.
We try our best.
And you guys have experienced both Americans right now, as we have a battle between Iberica Racing and Pure Racing Team 2. Iberica Racing on 9-lap fresher tires, so this should be a little bit easier for them.
Yeah, Iberica Racing Team 16 laps since the last stop, Pure Racing Team 25, so perhaps into this lap or into the next lap, the Pure Racing Team will be in the pit lane.
Yeah, they've been doing a good job since we've last mentioned them, very quietly making their way into the top 15 pretty securely.
So if it hasn't been mentioned enough or at all already, this is the 8th time Masters of Endurance has run a 24-hour race. This is the first one in iRacing, 7 between 2005 and 2012 in Live for Speed.
Iberica Racing huge off there.
That's a 1X.
Yeah, that is a 1X. We have picked that up. Also want to note that...
That's another 1X.
Yes, it is. I believe that Virgil Racing will be pitting soon, and wow, okay. They're pitting right now, and Anders Dahl, many know, racing either the Roof C-Spec car, also has raced the Roof track before, I believe, mainly the C-Spec, and he will be getting in for Virgil Racing here. Saw a tweet by them. It's his first time in Masters of Endurance, actually. Hope he enjoys his stint, or stints, I should say. hopefully they didn't go and put his first time in MOE, putting me on the night stints. If so, that's pretty harsh.
For some reason, didn't Anders Dahl do LFS though?
I think it was a different Dahl. I know who you're talking about. It's a different one. Very similar name, at least. I do know who you're talking about. Team TTL also in the pits. Ian Travis taking over the car. This now as we're getting into the stages of pit stops once again.
So most drivers getting, 26, 27 laps in reality?
I also got word that I believe Virgil Racing had a little bit of damage there entering the pits, and we see that now on the left side of their car. That damage looks like it was from another car just recently, and that's why Virgil Racing entered the pits. I believe it would be New World SimSport Scarlet. Also, that there's another little battle for position here. The Birka Racing team, who we just noted, about 17 lap tires, and Robin Friskops, which somehow says he's on 29 laps into his stint. He is not. He's about 3 laps into his stint. Now is a pass for position going into Blanchimont. Wow. Another note, Sauskevicus really has been putting down some really good lap times here. Now only 4 seconds behind Team Redline. Their stint's separated by 9 laps. So they're definitely trying to extend it and see what they can get out of it. Battle on track brewing up between Direct Clutch Motorsport and Pure Racing Team 2. Pure Racing Team 2 on completely fresh tires. Oh, sorry, that's not even Direct Clutch Motorsport, my bad. That's AB Racing Black. Number 75 car. My apologies. Fresh tires versus very old tires here. Currently they're just riding behind. I believe this would be the last lap for Pure Racing Black, however, I don't know, Pure Racing Team doesn't have that big of a run here. One note also that Core Motorsports has entered the pits. Currently still in the pits. Alexander Voss going to be taking over the car.
Also, the race draft on.
Yes, they do.
What way to lick home?
Not flipping out though. This is a surprise. Just want to note that race leader. Oh, actually, we need to figure this out here. Number 113 actually has front end damage. This is big here. Pitting 2 laps early before the end of their stint. Normally they go 27 laps, I believe.
I think I just saw him upside down as I was winding through a replay.
Yeah, we're going to get some people on this to, it's probably too far back to do a replay. However, to show you guys out there watching. Thought they were in pits for a routine pit stop, but it looks like they've had issues. This is GT Ross Silver. They've been battling with NX Racing Red and also Team Redline pretty much the entire race. They're on a separate pit strategy, possibly trying to save a pit stop. And that would have been really big toward the end of this race.
I'm having a strange replay. He was inverted, facing the wrong way at the top of Radeon. At the start of Kemmel Straight, so I don't know if he got it wrong coming out of Radeon. But I don't know if it's lag that was causing the jumpiness or what. But some incident
in that situation.
At the top of Kemmel.
Yeah, he's now going to go a lap down. It's rough to see. They've been doing a great job all day. Now it looks like it's going to be a really long repair, if it's even possible to repair. This is something we were speaking about earlier. We were wondering if, you know, the roof, very, very strong pace, we thought it had, but we were wondering how it was going to be over the course of the race. It was very sensitive.
If we go back to Pure Racing Team and AB Racing Black, they're side by side at the start of Kemmel. No Lundberg for Pure Racing Team. He went off on the grass on Kemmel's
right, well, let's see. Yeah, he's like falling asleep there on the straightaway.
But he got a great run coming up over Rouge. Fair Davey Racing Black, and was side by side coming out of Radeon.
Yeah, just wanted to note something about the roofs. Is just a simple fact, you know, the engine is in the rear part of the car. They put a lot of stress on the rear tires. I think they wear too much, especially if you try to run too low of a wing and no wicker, that's for sure. And I believe it's really paying its toll over the course later in the stint. And as we could see, GT Ross Silver was 25 laps into their stint. So I'm going to believe that they just kind of lost it on their own there. Just rear tires probably just gave out, and it's extremely bad luck for them, but I think that's what happens really with that car. I think they had to, I think other roof teams, I think what they've done is run a little bit higher wing to preserve their rear tires more. See both Pure Racing Team 2, AB Racing Black's already hit a lot of traffic here. Whoa, R4R Motorsport deciding to. This is actually for position. R4R Motorsport, Sam Michaels. Right through the middle, passing Pure Racing Team 2, who very, very tight inside line, making sure everyone had room. For anyone who hasn't seen R4R Motorsport race before, pretty much brothers leading it, Scott Michaels and Sam Michaels. They get help from either other close friends or whatnot. And yeah, they formed a team together. Been around since Live for Speed days, and remember Scott Michaels from there. Do a good job together. Jump back up to the Glacier and Radicals Online 2 battle once again. I think Glacier Racing is possibly their best driver, Alexia Loma, at least currently so far this race. I may be wrong. tire to the other Glacier Racing drivers if you feel different about it. But looks like he's gaining back on Radicals Online 2. Gained 3 seconds the last lap alone. Actually going to go on board with Alexei Lama here. Oh, as you see a spin just in front. Good avoidance there. Spin just in front here. We're following along the number 35. Oh, yes, of Radicals Online 2. About as close as you want to get, really, to an accident like that. And as we're in replay, sorry about that. This is why I don't do replays too often. Glacier Racing got passed.
You could always do a replay of what you missed while you're doing the replay.
Yeah, and then I just get in a big bottleneck. Don't like doing that. Back to Sam Michaels here. R4 Motorsport. Oh! Interesting situation there. Did not expect that. Possibly AB Racing Black just had a slowdown. I'm going to say yes to that.
Were you asking me a question?
Nope. AB Racing Black looked like they had a slowdown and had to let both the R4R car and Pure Racing 2 team by. Currently just riding on board with Pure Racing 2. Hearing the nice sound of the McLaren as they're following along off our motorsport. Just want to note also that the GT Royal Silver team is still sitting in the pits, unfortunately. They've lost 2 laps now, possibly 3 laps. Oh, you see Pure Racing Team 2, yeah. Close moment.
Lundberg getting a little held up, I think, going through Blanchemont by the lapped cars, just by catching the unfortunate position.
Yeah, it's getting late for everyone. So, you know, people are going to, I don't want to say lose track of what's going on, but, you know, sometimes you just slip up a little bit.
By the way, Phil, I do have some word from Oscar Hardwick about his third race.
Did he win it also, or am I gonna?
No.
Oh, I'm highly displeased with
you. He came third, Oscar. His teammate won that third race.
Not good enough. Disappointed with you, Oscar.
See, he's doing some university revision right now.
Okay.
He might join us here at the top of the hour. He said he's going to leave his phone on next one when he's sleeping tonight, so whenever we want him back, we're just going to send him Facebook messages.
Alright, yeah, we'll blow up his phone at some time or another, AM our time or something.
No, I'm thinking like 3 or 4.
3 or 4,
He's 5 hours ahead, so 3 AM our time is 8 AM his time.
Oh yeah, that's perfect.
That's breakfast time.
Yeah. He'd wake up, grab him a little snack,
tell him to go get a bacon sarnie and show up.
Exactly. Alright, let's get back to the racing. So, we'll go...
And 8 a.m. UTC is 8 hours from home.
We to jump to, well, just online, or just on board with Pure Racing Team 2, but you see Pure Racing Team 1 there about to go a lap down, or another lap down, to an X Racing Red. However, they might have just got tired. I want to check that. And if so, they might actually pull away from an X Racing Red. An X Racing Red actually has fresher tires. The gap to red line still, still about 55 seconds. It's been pretty much that for the past 30 minutes or so. The 4 second gap we mentioned earlier between red line and Coanda Simsport has extended up to 6 seconds, and it looks like NX Racing Red had a slowdown penalty there. Lost a good 3 seconds there, having to slow down and serve that.
Yeah, he said Laurent Bataille was chasing the Pure Racing Team 1 car. Looks like he had a bit of a narrow push, as the Americans like to say, going up a rouge, and he had no other choice but to take over the corner, slow down pretty quickly. So, so as you said, well, getting tired for a lot of these Europeans. Of course, this isn't our first 24-hour race. I've never driven one. I've always been on the admin commentary side, but you've driven in 24-hour races. Getting it this time of night, what becomes the biggest challenge for teams?
I think it's just keeping everyone positive, keeping the energy up. Having to do stints between midnight and 5 a.m. It's not exactly fun. However, it's the life of an American, I guess, and a mainly European-based team. It's just you have to keep everyone's morale up. Don't let any little issue, bother them. Simply because when people get tired, emotions run a little bit higher, so you just have to make sure that, everyone's in check, and most likely things will go smooth.
Some strategies, of course, employed by several teams to keep overnight minimal staff awake. Sometimes with as few as two people staying awake through the middle of the night.
Yeah, normally the thing is, I would say probably 5 drivers for this race is probably the best, because then you can kind of just go like a Red Robin type cycle where each time someone's driving, they always have a backup. You never know, a computer could crap out or whatever, and you have to have someone there to jump in the car instantly and race. So it's always good to have a backup. Some of the teams that are doing this with 3 drivers, you guys are nuts. It's very tough to do that, in my opinion. You can do it. It's been done. But, it's hard to do that and have a backup all the time and, be ready to go. It's like Scott and Sam Michaels. There's no way they're sleeping tonight. And they're going to be, really tired when the morning, happens.
Yes, sir. Just looking through time and seeing if there's anything else. Close the gap, still holding about 0.8 seconds between Pure Racing Team and R4R. Gap between the next Blue and Radicals Online 2 down to about 1 second.
Yep, but it's shrinking a little bit every single lap. Second and a half last lap is how much an X Racing Blue call. Robin Friskop's in the car now. I believe this is his second straight stint. I'm so used to our old tracker where it kept track of all everybody's stints and whatnot.
Do have a fairly close battle on track, only about 6 laps apart on pit stops, between 38 car 88 or 80, and 31 shorts. 8 or 80, 7 laps since their last pit stop. Trinity just a lap or two out of their last pit stop.
Ah, yes, they're really close too.
And actually, GT Ross SST Silver is back on track. And, being reported by timing, is fairly close to this, but that may have been soon after a pit stop.
I see they currently have their pit road speed limiter on. It looks like they just entered their pit stall again. Just judging by the current speed when they entered the pits.
Which you get on the camera control application.
Yep.
Angelo Peter for Trinity Motorsports behind the wheel of that machine. He is in the Dietch Club. Just pronounce that missing. D-E-A-T-E-C-H. He has done 27 laps so far. And we've got the 8 or 80 car, Claude Maval from Canada. Early days for him, he's only on his 8th lap.
Also want to note that we will have a couple penalties flying in other people's way. Also, we just, we have a battle right here, as you can see. Team Redline also trying to squeeze in there. Looks like Ollie was able to split the two and get around those two lapped cars. There's also NX Racing Blue just passed Radicals Online 2. Sorry, NX Racing Blue just passed Radicals Online 2.
Right. Car 133, Sim Racing Portugal, for avoidable contact with other cars, or another car, I should say. And also number 2, Virgil Racing, getting a drive-through penalty for avoidable contact.
Now, Virgil Racing currently sitting in the 4th position, doing a nice, quiet job. Andrew Dahl just got into the car. As you can see, the front end or left front damage there. I believe this is right before they pit. They had some contact right here, actually, in the bus stop, and you see them already entering the pits to do their drive-through penalty.
They'll be passed by Core Motorsports, who's entering the chicane now. Glacier Racing might get past them on the way. Glacier Racing coming up to Blanchimont right now.
Yeah, I'm not sure exactly how much a drive-through costs. I know a pit stop in general costs 90-95 seconds, I believe. However, I believe a drive-through costs probably around 40 or 45 seconds. So yeah, he's going to lose out to Glacier Racing as well, unfortunately for him. Which Andrew Dahl, he has nothing to do with this. This is his first stint in the car this race, so. It's one thing in team racing, which he's not new to, but one thing in team racing is your teammates can give you penalties.
Absolutely. Of course, it takes the admin several minutes, sometimes, if not a couple hours, to get all the facts sorted through, collected. Sometimes it could be an hour or two later, before the pit stop happens, or before the penalty is issued.
Yeah, it looks like they lost 4 positions here, so going from 4th to back all the way to 8th. So, I'm sure they're upset with that, but yeah, it's just one of the things that comes with avoidable contact. Now they have two McLarens in front of them going side by side. Once again, these two are back battling for position. R4R Motorsport and Pure Racing Team 2. Also want to note that 8 or 80 just got passed by Trinity Motorsports. As you can see, it was into the bus stop. Pure Racing Team 2 hoping the same thing can happen for them. However, I think it's too far back now for any form of... That'd be an actual dive bomb. So I'm just going to lay back and wait. Pablo Lopez currently in the pits. For Iberica Racing Team. I believe actually this might be a driver change. I think he just got into the car.
Coming up on the halfway point of the stints for these two drivers that we're watching.
Yeah, no, we actually see Iberica Racing Team in the back just come out. That'll actually be for position. We should catch up to the fresher tires in this battle here in probably 3 laps or so, if that.
BMW versus McLaren in this battle?
BMW, it wasn't the last.
the joke name everyone calls it here in the Edmund realm.
What were you gonna say though before I interrupted you?
I've completely forgotten now.
You're gonna say something about last time or last round?
Oh, yes! Yes, last time at Suzuka, I believe it was the R4 guys. I think the Michael brothers were at the same house, so they did the old actual switch in the same scene thing.
Yeah, and at first, you know, we were kind of skeptical about it. Then we asked them, you know, hey, well, can you get video of it? We all have smartphones, or most of us have smartphones nowadays. And yeah, they ended up, you know, sitting there videoing it, made sure they got video of, you know, the lap and everything that they were on, made sure we could see that, you know, it's actually the race and they didn't just, you know, do it prior. And yeah, it was pretty cool to see that.
Well, it wasn't the first time it was done in MOA, it was done a couple times in the For Speed days.
Yep, Marius Gombeck and Martin Kronk. That was 2009. 24 hours.
And I think, didn't they do a webcam stream of the whole time?
Yes, but I do remember, yes, they did do webcam as well for part of the race. Otherwise, it was just simply, just a simple video showing us that, you know, they're doing a swap and whatnot. I think it would be kind of distracting to have someone sitting right there next to you. And, you know, telling you about the race and all that, because you can hear their voice. It's not like it's on TeamSpeak. It's not like it's just a radio talking to you. It's like an actual voice.
Yeah.
I'd find that bothersome, actually. I actually love when people talk to me in TeamSpeak when I'm racing. I'll go and I think probably the most that I'm, like, zoned in driving is when I'm having a conversation with somebody, because then I'm kind of just having, I'm in that relaxed state. And it's kind of a more natural way of driving. I'm all right. If I'm just 100% trying to pay attention, I feel like I make too many mistakes. And, you know, I just can't keep focused enough.
Yeah, you can't enough. That thing kind of feels.
Yeah, this is now switched to a 3-car battle. As you can see, Iberica Racing Team, Pablo Lopez at the wheel, starting to, chime into this battle here.
And the three major makes all represented right here in your picture.
Yep. Well, three of the four. I'll say the Ford's now a major make.
By
top 10 R's.
Okay, by major, I meant just quantity of them in this field.
Gotcha.
Looks like Pablo Lopez for Iberica getting a little bit of a slipstream run going into Blanchemont, but someone that you don't want in Blanchemont is to not have any front downforce. A couple lapped cars up ahead for these three to deal with. The first one that will count is Bakir Karaka for Team Turkey Motorsport, running in 50th position right now. And that was Pure Race Team going wide at La Source, letting
that was
Iberica
very wide
through. I shall take a look in the replay and see what happens, and he just kind of missed his turn, and if not, the entire breaking point. And Lopez Rodriguez says, thank you very much. My beer gaming take the long way around the first part of Lake Home to a lapped car, and we're getting held up in a Malmedy by the lapped car.
Oh, that was an interesting situation there for sure.
It's John Hill, John G. Hill for CTC Racing, car 2.
I think Iberica now is going to set focus on R4R Motorsports. I just wanted to note that also, if you guys are new to watching Masters of Endurance, or you know, maybe not watch round two, Iberica Racing Team actually won round two. what was a pretty spectacular race, to say the least. Currently having troubles with, I don't think they've really had any forms of contact, really, but you know, drive-through penalty for off-track. Actually, I think possibly two off-track penalties. One for a slowdown in a rouge that they did not decide to slow down for. Yeah, for our motorsport going around the outside of Mad Cow Racing, it was risky.
It looked like America caught him at a fairly decent time. Kind of running off right on the exit of one, so a bit of time lost. And America getting a great run through the chicane right on the back. R4R Motorsport.
Wouldn't be surprised to see Pablo go for it.
He does inside. And clears it. No reply from Sam Michaels.
Yeah, Birka's on those fresh tires. Sam Michaels is almost done with, well, actually, no, not almost done with his. Just passed halfway in his stint. Birka Racing only on lap 3, so. That's how it is.
That's the way it is.
Currently on track, we still have 54 cars, by the way. 54 cars. As we see R4R fighting back here. Wow. Surprised to see any fight from either of them, really. Currently looking at Last Lap Motorsports ahead of All-Star Racing, Team 1.
Yep, I just waiting for a break in that last battle to mention it. Is Alex Lang in the All-Star Racing Team number 1 car. Helpful that they have a giant number 1 circle on the roof of their car. Getting a great grab early in the Kemmel Straight. Paul Darwin,
last lap
motorsport. Lap's concentration, yep. Tipping in the grass. And to the inside of Lake Home goes Lang, and completes it. LLM, see the timing, that is 17 laps since their last stop, 11 laps since last All-Star Racing Team pit stop.
All-Star Racing's been up and down today, mainly in the top 20.
So hearing from race control that car number 133 did not serve their drive through the avoidable incidents within sufficient time, so the next level of escalation is stop-go penalty.
Yeah, I don't know why you would want to have a stop and stop-go penalty instead of just serving your drive through, but okay.
The unfortunate thing about iRacing right now is you can't, as an admin, give an actual drive-through. The only thing you can give is a stop-go of that sort.
Yeah, it's been asked before why, and I think the response was somehow it's difficult to do.
But doesn't the simulation automatically go through sometimes?
Nope. The only penalty you can get from the simulation is stop-go penalty.
So really, it knows when you enter pit lane, knows when you exit, so...
I agree, I know. We have Klaus Giegas for Cohen SimSport just entered the pits. Driving around to his pit stall now. Remember, they're about 9 laps off sequence with the rest of the field due to the accident that occurred really early on in the race, actually. Andre Butcher exiting turn 9, no-name corner, as most people call it. There was another team was recovering and possibly recovered in a terrible fashion and really damaged the Cohen SimSport car. However, they were able to get back to the pits, use one of their 2 fast tows, which probably no team has anymore, and were able to get back on track, and I think it was the 25th position or so. As we see now, Yorn Yin's just got into the car.
We do have
see the 109 in the car, Cracks Racing Team.
Do have a battle at the last source here. Marlboro Motorsports, about halfway through their stint. Only 8 laps into the stint for Trinity Motorsports, but Marlboro Motorsports can get around Trinity. That might be another position they can get later in the race.
Yeah, they also just both passed Gator 80 as well.
Well, I think Trinity got to slow down. They're tapping the brakes. Did it go? Yeah, that's a slowdown. Did it go quite a little bit left at the Radeon? Don't think it was really that far. Looking at the replay, and actually, yeah, that was pretty well curved. I think midline of the car looked like it was well over the curbs, if just barely.
Just want to note Trinity Motorsports 3 just entered the pit, since we're looking at Trinity Motorsports 1. Also, a AB Racing battle, basically. I believe this is their black car versus their...
silver car, I think it was. Yes.
Yes.
AB Race... let's see. That's P26. AB Racing black, 6 laps since their last stop. AB Racing Silver, 17 laps since their last stop. So that's battle for P25 and 26. And
I think their roof has done a strategy where they're trying to go a little bit farther with fuel.
In the distinctly recognizable Mad Cow Racing scene just ahead.
Yeah, I can't ask what that looks like. It's pretty obvious.
By the way, we do want to take a moment to wish everyone watching a good 2015. We're 10 days past it, so it's late to say straight up Happy New Year. But, yes, good luck to all for 2015. Hopefully, you get plenty of sim racing.
We just saw AB Racing Black, they get a slowdown penalty for Rouge. Been seeing that a lot lately. Back to Trinity Motorsports, trying to pass Ader 80 once again.
Angelo Peter. That Trinity blue and black BMW Z4.
Also want to note quickly that Sequoia in a SimSport car. Remember, they enter the pits, they exit the pits, and guess what? They're still in third. So they've pretty much just fixed their issue of where they're going to be currently. Secured a third place position right now.
Coanda, of course, winners of round one at Road America.
Yeah, stellar head-to-head battle against Team Redline for literally the entire race. Ended up 9 seconds apart. Coanda kind of playing the strategy game and was able to save a pit stop.
Then Coanda having misfortunes last round with encountering incident scenes at inopportune times, which reappeared in front of him this time. Here at
yep.
Spa.
But they've recovered really well. They've had plenty of time. Last race, they actually recovered well. However, it was only a 6-hour race. So this race, they've done a stellar job as well. All the way back up to third, and it's not even halfway through. It's not even a third of the way through the race yet. So, yeah, they've done
Trinity
a great job.
Trinity Motorsports getting around 8 or 80 at the chicane. Flicked the 8 or 80, just maybe yielded the position.
Yeah, Trinity's already passed him once. And then Trinity got the slowdown penalty, so Trinity caught him again, and they're like, okay, you can do it now. Now the field's starting to spread out a little bit. Finally, we actually have cars that are spreading out. Amazing it took this long.
It's amazing how you do these races, and it always seems like there's close action even at the bitter end of the race.
Oh yeah, the last 24-hour race, battle for fifth position, literally second to last corner on the last lap, and there was like the slightest bit of contact made, but also a car was going over the curb at the same time, ended up with one of the cars rolling. So your whole 24-hour race ended two corners before the finish line. Yeah, there's always action all the way to the end of the race, really.
Yep, plenty of 24-hour races. Not just Emily, but other series, online and real life, having close finishes. Real life, of course, you have the occasional more safety car periods. Some online series using safety car.
Yeah, we've seen it before.
So, we'll take a moment here while things are fairly quiet in the race to mention what will in the next couple days be a sad anniversary. It will have been 1 year this January 14th since a good friend of MOE and some of the drivers in it from the LFS days, Tomek Nojcik, had a fatal automobile accident just after a 12-hour race in Live for Speed last year when MOE was still on hiatus.
Yeah, he was definitely a competitor, that's for sure. One of the fastest guys that was in MOE at the end of MOE and pretty much in Live for Speed in general. Always dedicated, put in a ton of laps for practice, and one of those guys who in any endurance race, whether it be 3, 6, 12 hours, he's running his best laps pretty much every lap. So really good guy, and it sucked to see him go almost a year ago now.
Yeah, it was just before the last 24-hour race in Speed, the news came. Yeah. A great rival to maybe, like, especially Isaac Price and others, so we do pause to remember him at this time of year. If we get any of these drivers that knew him in, That's thoughts on him. He did win the last MW 24-hour GT1 class and live for speed in 2012. I believe along with Nicky Dekovic. I think Yanni Tormola was on that team. A couple drivers who have done iRacing before. So, Phil.
Yes.
You know this IGP thing?
Yeah. Oh. Are we gonna? Should we get out of another? We should get out of it. Yeah, we probably should.
You know, again, we've got. I don't even know how many. Oh, we got 21 left. So let's give out our fourth code of the day, shall we? IGPManager.com/special. New and existing accounts, as long as you're logged in, you can use it. First one to use the code receives 1 year free of the 2D viewer. This code for this trip around the clock, 2Bravo88Bravo, 2B88B. First one to use it gets a year of 2D viewer. Phil, for those who may not know what IGP and 2D viewer is, why don't you re-explain it?
Okay, so IGP basically, if you like Formula One, if you like any type of racing, to be honest, it's essentially a Formula One manager game. So you manage your own team, you do with it what you want to do with it. You want a certain engine, you want a certain, you know, designer, you know, certain tire, certain fuel, whatever. You know, you want to set up your car in a certain way, you want certain drivers, you can do all that. Any way, shape, or form, race with your friends, whatnot. You want to do it every day, you want to do it, you know, every week, doesn't really matter. You can set it up pretty much however you want. During the races, you can, you know, control your drivers and whatnot as well, based upon their tire temperatures and, you know, fuel usage and whatnot. So it really is a manager game. It's 100% what it is. This free 2D offer that Jack Bassford and IGP Manager in general has given to you guys, essentially, is you get 2D for 1 year, meaning you can see the races as they're happening live, and, you know, you see all your competitors, you see all your own tire temperatures and whatnot, see when to use DRS, when to use KERS, all that stuff. So, yeah, it's a good offer. I believe it's 30 pounds now?
I was looking at it the other day. I think he reduced the price down to 20 pounds.
Well, if not, we'll just
still,
say it's
a good value.
It's a good offer. Yeah, it's a lot of fun. We've actually done it ourselves. We used to have a TeamSpeak league, and all of us would jump in TeamSpeak, you know, a certain time of the day. I believe it was 3 times a week. And we would all race and, you know, have a good time. We saw, once again, Trinity Motorsports and 8er80 having a little battle. Let's see, we have... It's Glacier Racing up, too. Currently in the 5th position.
4GT update.
Yeah, 4GT update now. Sorry we don't have any music to go along with you guys. Alexander Voss for Core Motorsports directly in front of them. About 13 seconds ahead. And then let's look at behind. We have Robin Friscops for NX Racing Blue. Once again, about 13 seconds behind. So Alexei Aloma currently is just cruising. Trying to put down as best laps as possible. Hopefully going to close in on the people ahead of him. The only real thing you can hope for.
Oh, I have neglected you, Twitter, in the last few minutes, so let me go ahead and look it and see what's going on. 36 minutes ago, Cole Motorsports tweeted that after some trouble in the first couple stints, we've gotten everything sorted. And Yusa handed the card to Alex. Bert Eichmann's for tweeted earlier.
Yeah, I saw that tweet
as well.
I forgot. Yes, that's Flux Racing.
Flux Racing.
Yep.
He said 38 minutes ago, bedtime for me. Tomorrow morning, early wake up for two stints of 2 hours each.
Yeah, some people are already getting in some sleep. They're going to be waking up early, though, and trying to help out the people who cannot get that sleep and have to stay up later.
Absolutely. Anyone up for an interview? Let us know. Get to us on Twitter. You can direct message us at Masters of Indu. Or you can highlight me in IRC, in the Game Church Network, channel hashtag MOA. I'm the op in the channel, so you should be able to easily find me. Or just talk in all in the spectator chat. One of us will see it. We'd love to hear how your team is running. Let's see what. Got a lot of first timers to Masters of Endurance. Some might even be their first 24-hour race.
Some even their first endurance race.
A lot of first timers. Love to hear how you're handling it. Of course, we'd love to hear some of the old timers.
Speaking of 24-hour races, iRacing just released their Road Warrior schedule, which is starting off with the 24 hours of Daytona. Most people in Masters of Endurance know that the COTA round is scheduled for pretty much the exact same time as the 24 hours of Daytona. Don't worry, we already know that iRacing won't change their date, which I don't blame them. It's 1 week after the real race. However, we might be changing our date to 1 week later. Well, it doesn't clash with NEO or any other popular league when it comes to endurance racing and whatnot. So we think we might be moving that back. However, that means that the final round, you have like 2 weeks in between. This isn't, set in stone yet. We're still going to be talking about it after this race. Give you guys plenty of notice. However, if we do move the COTA round back, you'd have a two-week gap in between the final two rounds. And the reason for not moving back the final round at Bathurst is simply because Drivers World Championship is starting back up. So we want to make sure that we're not stepping on any toes. Don't want to clash with, DWC or iRacing's endurance races or NEO endurance races. Want to make sure that, everyone has their own weekend and it's all in good fun. As we saw, GT Ross Orange just came out of the pits and passed All Star Racing, Team 1. Looks like pit stops are starting to happen again. X Racing Red just entered the pits. Just behind them is Vortex Sim Racing. This is 1st and 25th. I believe we didn't talk to Vortex Sim Racing yet. However, pretty sure they want to get back up there to the places that they were fighting with at the beginning of the race. This is the GT Ross Orange car. Just came out of the pits on fresh tires, and we'll be catching the last lap motorsports car here soon. Also want to note that in X Racing Red, they made their pit stop, or at least they're still making their pit stop, and Jake Sturgis is jumping back in the car. Gonna ride on board here with Ivan from GT Ross Orange. He tries to chase down Paul Darling of Last Stop Motorsports. Oh, we just saw the last lap motorsports car run wide there.
Run wide at Brussels. And let's... Ivan Sol for GT Ross ST Orange up into the 17th position.
It looks like the last lap motorsports car is suffering possibly from some understeer right now, not sure. He now has the All-Star Racing team pretty much right behind them.
Last up motorsports car starting 58th position.
Yeah, they've done a pretty good job moving up.
Currently in 18th. In a way though, sometimes you would like to start at the back of a 60 car field. So you can just kind of lay back and avoid the problems that generally manifest themselves. Oh, that is quite a bit of understeer to wash them off.
Yeah. Don't want to do that too much.
And he,
and he goes into the pits.
So All-Star Racing Team advances a position.
Let's jump on board with... let's see.
Pick someone at random.
I know, that's what I was trying to do actually. I'll just click on... I'm closing my eyes and clicking on somebody. Oh, okay. Speaking of Vortex Sim Racing. Let's go on board here with a lap. Fresh out of the pits here.
Jules Guez, the French region.
You just experienced a lap around Spa. Vortex Sim Racing's Joel Guez. Pretty clean lap, actually.
Do remember all that although we started the race on the downhill run to Eau Rouge, the finish line for the Spa combined circuit is the Grand Prix finish line at the exit of the chicane. So you can't necessarily rely on a good exit to the chicane. You might want to get your last lap move done going into it. Wintertime is often the best time for these endurance races when there's not much to be doing outside. Especially around this time when everyone may be still on a winter break from work or hot school.
Yeah. The off school and then also cooler temperatures. Don't have to worry about PC and stuff overheating. Or your brain overheating, I guess. Can stay pretty calm.
Yep. The back-to-school thing might be hampering some university students here in America this Monday night with the National Championship Hand Egg, or Football for the Americans, game between the Oregon Ducks and the Ohio State University Buckeyes.
Yeah, I just realized I'm also missing the NFL playoffs. Shame on me.
You can watch, like, I think you can watch both games tomorrow. This will be finished in time. Isn't the Dubai 24 hours on this weekend?
You, sir, have already missed it. It was a Friday-Saturday race.
Oh, it is a Friday. Jeez, I know Formula E was today.
I think this has seriously been the oddest thing ever. My remote for my TV is dead. No battery life.
Get some
batteries. Yeah, well, I can't get up right now. I want to watch Vortex Sim Racing try to close down on AB Racing Silver. Or we actually have another one. Let's go on board with Jack Sedgwick here. Looks like he's chasing down Pablo Lopez, Iberica Racing Team. 12 lap tire difference, so that's definitely a reason behind it.
Jack Sedgwick, famous in the LFS MOE days for rolling.
And not even in the MOE days, just LFS in general. He was very, very good at rolling a race car. Never thought it could even be possible. And it wasn't like it was on purpose. It was just somehow, way, shape, or form, he'll spin and he'll clip a curb properly or go into the sand properly or hit the wall properly. Somehow his car ends up on its roof and it's... Everyone who watched any broadcast or race with them knew eventually it was going to happen some race. It's kind of upsetting for him, but he enjoys it.
Well, of course, the cars used in endurance racing at LFS most of the time were the GTR cars, which had perhaps one of the most flippable cars in LFS, the XRR.
Yeah, that car, if you hit... Well, Lift for Speed had some pretty high curbs in some tracks. And if you hit a curb just right with that car, you could easily be a goner. I note that Alexi Aloma for Glacier Racing have pit, and I believe he's exiting the pits now. Yes, he is. This will be his second straight stint. Simon Trudell for Team Kimura also entering the pits. Team Redline also made a pit stop. Ollie Pacalo got out, and Alexi Yusi Yakalo got in. currently still in the second position with Coanda SimSport, who, when Team Redline came out of the pits, were 5 seconds behind or so, and now they're close to 7 since Coanda SimSport's on a different strategy completely. Their tire difference is quite large, so that's why you see a sudden drop in time.
Jake said we're just over half a second a lap faster last lap than Pablo Lopez for Iberica.
Yeah, he's slowly catching him here. Oh, caught him a lot through Pujan there. Actually having to wait on him.
Jack looks to the inside in Afanyas. Thinks better of it. Iberica getting a little bobble on at the midpoint of the corner.
Yeah, Pablo braked late and then also tried to cover it and had him run a little wide there.
Through Stavolo on the way to curve Paul Frere. One lap car up ahead. Jack runs it wide. Lopez taking a somewhat defensive line.
Oh yeah, they have a lapped car directly in front as well. Ooh, Pablo, you could see was sideways there. Exiting the corner.
Lopez is doing a little bob and weave, it looked like. Lapped car dives out of the way at the source.
I don't think he's close enough here to get a good run. I may be wrong though. Let's see what Pablo's gonna charge in pretty hard here.
Lopez is trying to stick around the outside for Malmedy.
Yeah.
Can't do it. Switch back. Nope.
Pretty hard race in there.
Yep, Sidwick through.
Now let's jump from one onboard battle to another here. Actually, I don't know if it's much of a battle anymore. A 102 car. Mad Cow Racing 2 just behind GT Rose Orange. Actually, see just ahead of this battle, ahead of Mad Cow Racing in it, you'll see another Mad Cow Racing BMW. Pretty heavily damaged, actually. Actually, something must have happened here to the GT Rose Orange car. You see the last lap time, they actually lost 16 seconds. And it wasn't no pit stop or anything like that, so...
Wasn't situation no pit stop.
Sorry. I can't talk. All-Star Racing team's currently in the pits. For those looking at the live timing, you'll see Alexi Aloma has 30 laps currently on his stint. That is lying to you. He only has about 4 laps on his stint currently.
Basically, if you see any number above 26 or 27, assume it didn't change.
Yeah.
So fortunately, sometimes iRacing
sometimes through the API isn't sending an actual pit stop, as in a pit stop has occurred. So I don't know why, but yeah. So Mad Car Racing 2 has fallen back a bit from GT Race Orange. I'm going to jump back up front to mention that Jake Sturgis for NX Racing Blue is basically kept around this 50-second margin to Team Redline.
Yeah, it looks like the order has certainly moved itself around a little since I went off to do some driving a while ago, although mostly similar names up towards the top end of the field at the moment. Again, it seems like as soon as you get Enzo Benito out of that Team Redline car, it's just not as astonishing as it previously was. Just leaves other teams like NX Racing and Coanda to start taking advantage of that. And to be fair, given that Coanda had that incident early on, they've done a fantastic job to get back to where they are.
Yeah, they're one pit stop off right now. However, when they make that pit stop now, they're secured where when they pit, they come out in the third position still.
So that's a really good fight back, actually, because it was a properly big hit that they had with the, I believe it was the 91 car about four hours ago.
93,
I believe? 93. Yeah. I can't remember the team name of the driver at the time, but...
Rincon.
It was a nasty old bump, wasn't it?
Yeah, they've been fighting back, been doing a good job. They're currently basically 30 minutes off where everybody else is. So, you know, they pit, and then everybody else goes another 30 minutes, and then they pit. So it kind of looks awkward. So they start out the stint, they're like 5 seconds behind Team Redline. Currently they're 11. So it's just how it's been for the past 6 hours or so.
Yeah, so these guys are doing well now. Approaching the end of, I believe that's going to be the 8th hour of the race?
Yes. You might have also missed GT Rolls Silver. They were up front. However, late in their stint, possibly the lap they were about to pit, maybe the lap before, they lost it at the top of Eau Rouge and had a welcome to the wall, I guess you could say.
Yeah, it's never a small accident.
Nope, and ended up, I don't want to say ending their race, but currently they're down in 53rd position. So, you know, they were the roof that was really pushing the BMW of NX Racing Red and the McLaren of Team Redline. But now it's BMW, McLaren, BMW with Coanda SimSport. And now we have... the first roof is Core Motorsports in fourth position.
Yeah. So interesting to see that it's still all four of the manufacturers running in the top five. So
yeah.
Nice competitive spread in the field, I think.
Yeah, we have, interesting actually, we have Core Motorsports that you see currently right now. Next to the Marlboro car there. And they're 7 seconds ahead of Alexia Loma and Glacier Racing.
That, the Ford seems to come to its own sort of like after about half an hour of driving.
Yeah, Lexi's been, they pretty much went through their roster of drivers, I believe, besides Johnny Backman, who they said was on reserve. But, you know, they've been pretty strong. But I think Aloma kind of has the little edge over them. Possibly been, you know, practicing a bit more for it. And it's really been showing, actually. Been doing a good job. And once they've hit this fifth position, they've been there pretty much pretty securely. The only other time was they were battling with Radicals Online 2. And that battle was for a while, actually. You missed a good three-hour battle there. They were within a second pretty much the whole time.
It's pretty impressive of them. But again, the 4GT has been made more competitive for this round than it has been in previous rounds, but I think it's fair to say it's still a bit of a pick, particularly to get going quickly over one lap.
Yeah, and I'm actually scared to think of, you know, where would Glacier Racing be right now if that car was actually, you know, even with the other ones. Because, I mean, they're in fifth right now, and it's not like they're in a terrible fifth. Sure, they're quite a ways behind the leader, but it's not that bad.
Well, like, they're only a lap and a bit behind.
Yep.
Like, to be fair, it does seem a long way, but after 7.5 hours of racing, you're still only talking, like, less than a tenth the corner that they're losing out on, really.
Yep.
So, fantastic work from them to be maintaining that position, I guess, is the most important element. And nice to see Jack Sedgwick in the NX Racing Blue BMW running in sixth as well.
Yeah, we actually needed somebody. We were kind of running short on drivers for that car, so he didn't have any teammates for Gotta Go Fast Motorsports, or Team Gotta Go Fast. So
yeah, well,
we decided to snatch him.
No one wants to run with Joe Lettorelli, I think.
It would have just been him and Jack, so I don't
think
they
had a really bad time with it at Road America, as you remember.
Ah, yes. Suzuka was fun for them as well.
Yeah, some, like, you do find that as a driver or as a team, sometimes you just have round after round, you cannot find any luck at all. Like, it does eventually come to you, but you can have horrid runs.
Yeah, they were driving the McLaren, and to be honest, they were running setups that were probably, you know, a little bit too edgy. So they were paying the price for it, you know, 4 hours or so into the races. Currently looking at a battle on track between the number 59, which is Pure Racing Team... I don't want to get this wrong. I want to
three.
Say Team 3, yeah. Okay, good. Pure Racing Team 3. Versus number 45, which is New World Sim Sport Scarlet. Scarlet actually is technically the third car, so two teams with their third car battling each other for the 28th position.
You tend to find that quite often the numbers associated to a car don't actually correlate with that being like a number one car or anything like that. It's just grouped them together, put them in cars sort of as they turn
yep.
up quite often in teams.
Yeah, that's really been the case. It's quite humorous. Like, NX Racing, for example, I believe they were wanting, like, their blue car was going to be their main car, and then suddenly the first round rolls along, and the red car finishes third. So, everything
changed.
Did NX
Racing blue car not get to start because of
yes,
just
because
bug?
Of, yeah, some form of iRacing bug to where, when they joined, it for some reason gave them the wrong car and the wrong number. It was like they didn't even go off of what they chose. They just put something random. So yeah. So
I
they
that would have been a big factor.
Sure. Yeah, I put them in McLaren instead of BMW, so it really messed everything up.
Virgil Racing as well, running in eighth position. They didn't feature very much in the top 10 or even 15 for the first couple of hours, so again, it gets to that point where you get a certain number of hours into the race and that just being consistent will put you in a good position.
Yeah.
Same for JCL Sim Racing, actually, running outside the top 20 for the first couple of hours.
They've done a good job as well. I think they finished 11th at Suzuka, so that's good.
I mean, the guys at JCL have shown a number of times recently just how competitive they can be. The group of French drivers there always have been on pace, so it doesn't surprise me to see them in the 10th position. It surprised me more to see them outside the top 20 early on.
So joining us in the commentary box from Slow Fins, Antti Tuominen. Hope I got that right. You told me earlier that you were trying some security testing of the circuit and noticed the railings didn't quite bend when driven it.
Yes, we were a bit worried that there might be some slack in the railings, but they seem to be firmly attached and it was our car that bended instead.
Well, have you recovered at least somewhat satisfactorily from that yet?
Yes, our car is running fine now. We have had some repairs, but everything is fine now, and we will continue on climbing up the steps towards the top.
So have you used both of the fast tows granted?
We didn't tow at all. We drove to the pits, but all the repairs are done, and there's still some minor bending of the seat control, but everything is okay, and the car handles great.
All right, apart from that shunt, how's the race been?
Besides all these exciting bits, well, pretty smoothly. And I beat my first double stint a while ago, and I was all pumped up with adrenaline and had a great time.
Well, it's good that you guys are carrying on and enjoying yourself despite having a large accident. Presumably everyone on your team is from Finland, so explain to us how you're all combating the difficulties that are a 24-hour race, because presumably some of you are going to have to be running pretty unsociable hours.
Yes, but of course, hopefully that's the case for everyone for 24 hours. But yeah, well, it doesn't seem to be an issue. We have five drivers, I think, for the race, and everybody gets a bit of sleep as well.
Well, that's certainly the way that you want to be running it. Running in 40th position at the moment, and no doubt you've been a bit further back than that and also further forward at other points. What kind of position are you hoping to be at, say, a couple of hours before finishing, ready for that final stretch to the end?
That's a tough one to say. I guess it pretty much depends on will there be people in the front having trouble. So we will just now focus on doing lap after lap decent times and driving up to our best abilities.
Okay, well, I think that's all from me. If there's anything that you want to say to supporters or drivers, friends of yours that are watching the stream, then feel free to do so. But after that, we'll send you back to manage, run and drive the car, and wish you the best of luck with moving further forward than you are at the moment.
Actually, though, one question I have. Slow Fins, you should be moving known as Slow. Is that any reason for calling yourself Slow Fins?
Well, we just couldn't come up with a name for the team. There has been so much talk about everything being an alien, then we decided that, well, us meatpackers might be in the race as well.
Well, Antti, again, any team websites, Facebook, Twitter accounts you want to tell us about?
Well, I'm streaming the race, except for now, on hitbox/ANPPA. And, well, I actually have to do a bit of an apology. I noticed only now that the race is running, I have all the paint schemes there, that there is one massive endurance logo upside down in our car. That is an accident, sorry.
Oh, we found it humorous. We thought it was on purpose, thinking like if you guys rolled, we could read Masters Endurance logo correctly.
It sort of fits to the general scheme. None of us are really painters, so I personally volunteered to do at least something. So we have a red pouch we are driving now.
Alrighty, well. We do wish you the best for the rest of the race, and of course the rest of the season.
Thank you. It's been a great racing so far.
Alright, thank you, and good luck, and enjoy the rest of the season. did just recently have a big crash for car number 133. That is the Simracing Portugal car coming out of Eau Rouge. Ran it wide at top of Radeon, hit the wall on the outside, and flew across the track to the wall on the left-hand side of track.
Yeah, I think his free toes are used up, so I think they might be done.
Yep.
Certainly doesn't look promising. Looks pretty sorry sat in the pit lane, doesn't it?
Yeah.
I didn't see any smoke coming out of the engine right after the crash, though. Being asked to go through the retirements, but I don't quite know who's all completely retired yet. Once I find the last car that's running, I can go through retirements.
I think it's,
I think it is GT Ross
SSTs. Yeah, they look to be still going, so it'd be the sixth retirements after that.
Yes. Falcon GP number 76. Stopped 44 laps ago. Well, they're down 44 laps, I should say. So they have completed 195 laps. Question mark?
150. They completed.
There we go. Yeah, there's. Look at the color, forgive me. New World SimSport 2 also out of it. Direct Clutch Motorsports also out. Rincon Racing not completing laps. USCSR Team Frenzy also out. Oh, the 59th actually could take the start. Velocidade Endurance Racing Team unfortunately unable to take part in the race due to a CTC Racing Team accidentally joining two cars. So instead of having a full 60 car grid at start, had a slightly short field.
Yeah, it was pretty gutting for Velocidade. One of those incidents that really shouldn't happen. You really gotta, double check before you register for a session. Especially one where you use all 60 slots.
So, still watching the closest battle on track, I believe, which is the battle for 27th position between the Pure Racing Team 3 BMW and the number 45 McLaren of New World SimSport Scar.
Yeah, we haven't switched from there yet. Just been following along to see if anything's going to happen. They've been pretty much a half a second for the past 10 laps or so. Been looking at other cars in the meantime. I believe, yes, we have a Birka Racing Team currently just entered the pits. Pablo Lopez pitting their car.
So presumably Iberica must have hit some problems, actually.
Yeah, they've had a couple drive-thrus for exceeding the track limits.
Ah. Other teams that seem to have moved forward a bit, R4R, running well, 14th position. Yeah. Not really someone that we mentioned much earlier today.
Not sure what happened to Team TTL, they're currently 25th. And dropping back. Not quite sure what's going on there. They're in the top 10 early on. Definitely not the case so far. This stint.
Yeah, I forget who it was driving them, but TTL are actually keeping quite a few people honest at the front early on, but that car's going slowly at the moment.
Yeah, it's very odd. It's almost like he's not using full throttle or something.
Maybe it's a fuel issue, or it's unlikely, but more likely there's some sort of damage to his car. It doesn't go into the pit lane
situation. Yeah, I don't know what's going on there. hopefully it's just for a lap or two and then he's fine. I don't know.
Team TTL, if you're listening, feel free to let us know what's going on, because I'm a bit confused by that one.
We have another little battle for position here. Number 90 of Dream Factory. And the number 109, I want to say Crax Racing Team, and it is. Seeing the 109 a little much, or pretty much all over the place today. All sorts of different positions. Dream Factory's been pretty quiet, however.
Yeah, not necessarily featuring too much Dream Factory, but if anything, if you're not the fastest car on track, that's certainly the way you want to go. If we're not talking about you, it means you're staying out of trouble. So
that's definitely true. We one of the ones like Core Motorsports, for example, they're currently in fourth. They finished fourth the first two races of the season, and they're running fourth in the third race of the season. But they do it quietly. You don't hear about them probably half the race, simply because, well, they're not really doing anything. They're just minding their own business and doing the laps that they need to do. Sounds boring, but I mean, that's how you finish good.
Yeah, I guess in reality, the trick is to get out of the trap quickly and establish yourself some trap position and then just hold on to it in the most mundane way you physically can for the rest of the however many hours there are left.
Yeah, there was a situation where they got bullied a little bit early on by Virgil Racing and also a Birka Racing team. Just slight contact or whatnot. However, since then, they've just been running their consistent pace, and while other people have problems, they just keep on chugging. Actually set the fastest time out of the top five. The last lap.
Yeah, only just though. Team Red Line setting an extra.
Yeah, only 2/1000ths difference, but it's totally the fastest time.
It's good to see them running so closely in terms of their pace, to be honest.
Yeah, it's quite strange to see. You have the top three, which now they're separated by 70 seconds. However, then you see 2 minutes back to almost 2 minutes back to the fourth place car. The top three pace is just, it's crazy compared to the others. Coendo as well, they've been running an amazing pace in order to come from, I believe it was just outside the top 25, and now they're running third due to their accident like 6 hours ago. So they've done a really good job.
Well, Coendo's one of those teams where it's tricky to pick out a star driver from their lineup because all of them are so good.
Yeah.
It's really what you want to have entering an endurance race. It's having one driver that's 3 seconds quicker than everyone is no use if the rest of your drivers aren't matching the other people on the track. So you have one person that pulled you away for a stint, and then you lose it all the stint afterwards anyway when you make your driver swap.
Trying to look for battles we may see soon. Still, once again, you have Pure Racing Team 3 and New World Sim Sports Scarlet. This is another one of those half second in between, and they just ride like that for a while.
Well, if I was in their shoes nearly 8 hours into a race, I wouldn't be looking for a move unless a mistake opened it up. Because, if you're running in a decent position, you don't want to threaten the car at this point. With 16 hours left on the clock, you don't want to put yourself in a wall or in pit lane for a few minutes. You're going to be on the back foot. That's when you have to start pushing at a time that you don't want to. The best plan is obviously just to keep it clean so that you can drive a much more sensible pace and keep the car safe.
Yep. Pretty much what's been going on with quite a few guys. Some people have been a little aggressive. We actually had a penalty given out to Virgil Racing for some avoidable contact earlier. They were running fourth and they got dropped back to eighth, but they're slowly making their way back up there.
Yeah, gently catching Jack Cedric at the moment, the number 8 next race, blue car up in front. But again, it's sort of tenths either way each lap, so it's not an imminent battle. It's one that may well happen in the near future.
Yeah, Jack actually had a 20.8 last lap, which maybe a poor lap by his standards, but average racing caught up another 6 tenths there, so yeah, they're catching him mighty quick. But I believe Virgil Racing, I don't want to say this and be wrong, so I'm going to look first. They have 6 lap newer tires, so it's not that much. Coanda will be pitting probably in the next lap or two.
Yeah, so even though they're pitting on the hour, I presume that everyone else is currently about half an hour off of that anyway. Which would make sense, actually. I think that...
Also want to note that we have been testing, currently driving the Camaro 2 car. And then also, just ahead of them, by just ahead, I mean about 5 seconds ahead, we have GCL Sim Racing. We spoke about them earlier. Just kind of cruising around, ninth position right now. And pretty quiet, but if you remember, these two cars actually had a huge battle at the end of Suzuka last round. About a good 20-lap battle or so, where they were just door-to-door the whole time. It's great stuff.
Yeah, I mean, Thibaut Vernisse at the moment driving the JCL Sim Racing car, not setting the world on fire with his lap times, but they're certainly not non-competitive. I would think if he's not pushing, he could certainly respond to the kind of pace that Ben Testing is showing at the moment and put a fight up, although whether or not he will at this stage in the race is something completely different.
Yeah, right now it's at one of those points, it's actually what I was talking about earlier. Just hit midnight UK, so that's 1 a.m. for other parts of Europe. This is one of those moments where, you know, you're starting to get a little tired. It's 8 minutes in. Wow. 8 hours in. And, you know, you get a little tired, and this is where you start losing your concentration and whatnot, similar to what I'm doing right now while commentating.
I think, if anything, this is the stage of the race where all the teams wish they had some Australian drivers.
Yes.
Just as you get to that sort of, yeah, like you say, midnight to 2 a.m. UK time, that's when you want to have people just getting up, ready, raring to go over in Oz and that side of the world, ready to go. As we've been informed in the chat that Redline have had a crash.
Oh, they are in the pits right now. That's not good.
So that will promote Coanda presumably to an actual second position. And give NX Racing Red a heap ton of breathing room. It's Yoni Hagner, actually, I believe, that's letting us know about this. He's informing us that they flipped as well during this accident. Didn't quite see what happened. It looks like a pretty big off for Alexei Uciokola in that Team Redline car.
Yeah, earlier in the race... Ollie had an incident where in Blanchimont, we were watching him at the time live, and he lost the rear of the car and then snapped, and he did a 360, but he saved it, kept going. And maybe their car is, you know, pretty sensitive there in Blanchimont, so most likely have no fast repairs left, and they're getting a tow to the pits right now, I assume, and it's going to be a long wait in the pits to hopefully repair their car. Sensible.
I mean, if there is a silver lining to the very grey cloud that they've just gone and stuck themselves under, it is that there are 16 hours left.
Yeah.
And in 16 hours with a team of the quality of Team Redline, you can certainly still get back to a very good finishing position. Whether or not they will be able to get back to win is a completely different matter.
Just getting reports that it looks like he lost it in Eau Rouge. Not really more to say there, just that they lost it, and sounds like they hit the wall pretty hard.
So, crying shame for Team Redline. I think they're probably going to fall back maybe
currently
as far as
fifth
or sixth position.
Oh, they're fifth right now. It's going to be a while before they're passed for sixth, I believe. Not 100% sure. Nope, they just got passed for... Yeah, they're dropping back.
Up in seventh then, because Anders Dahl's pretty close behind Jack.
Yeah, this is going to be a while. Who knows if they even have the pit work or whatever starting now. So this is going to be a long wait for them, unfortunately. But, you know, it could happen to any one of these teams, to be honest.
Yeah, and that's one thing when you get a level of competition as high as is currently found in Masters of Endurance. You were talking earlier about Jack Sedgwick and Go Faster Racing struggling with relatively extreme setups. You get to a point where if you are running in that top 10, you can't really get away with running particularly neutral setups, and particularly things like the McLaren with the engine sitting back in the car and it being probably a little more naturally twitchy at certain points than other cars. It's a tricky one to do, and obviously there's going to be mistakes, and you spoke about Team Redline having that issue earlier on, so...
And now we have... I believe... Maybe it's just Jornjens? Yes, he's in the pits. And what you saw there was Jornjens technically going a lap down, because he's in the pits right now, getting service. He sees a Team Redline car right in front of him. And remember now, the Team Redline car was leading the points going into this race. So this is huge for them.
Well, given that you've got Coanda and NX Racing Red running so, well, yeah, running strong at the moment, that's got to be a right downer on their day, because they are the two that could very feasibly knock them off their perch, as it were, come the end of this round.
And we now see Enzo getting into the car. So I'm guessing the repair might be done soon. I see the pit time still going up, so they're definitely still repairing the car. Oh, and now Redline car is back on the circuit. Have a quick look at their car to see how bad the damage really is. Wow, to be honest, that car looks pretty darn good for having been in a massive accident.
Yeah, maybe they've gotten away with it. I remember commentating on another 24-hour race here at Spa earlier in the year, and Arthur R managed to crash into nearly everyone on the track in a HPD and continued to carry on with what seemed like no damage until eventually they wrote the car off. But you can get lucky sometimes and just have an accident in such a way that whilst you do get damage, it's nothing permanent, and maybe, just maybe, Redline got lucky in that regard and are going to carry on with a decent pace.
Yeah, it's a rough situation here for them. But if their car is... If their car is decent, which it looks decent somehow, then maybe, you know, they can come back up through, and I see them definitely able to get third position back. That's only 20 seconds or so up the road. So
it'll be very interesting to see how quick his Enzo's laps are, actually.
Yes, at the beginning of the race, he still has the best lap of the race, 17.7. So I'm curious to see what he can do, whether this car is, you know, fresh or not. If he hits a low 18, I'll say that the car is going to be okay. He obviously has a little bit of traffic now, so it doesn't look like, though, he's really holding anything back. As Enzo crosses the line here, we're going to pull up the results for you guys.
So, leading the race at the 8-hour mark, just gone past, is NX Racing Red. Jake Sturgis currently at the wheel of that one. Second position, the fantastically recovered Coanda Simsport BMW, currently being driven by Jornjens. Third position, another quiet but impressive display from the Core Motorsports guy, Danny Giusa, currently driving that one. Fourth position, probably the highest I think we've seen a 4GT run, although I believe it was a bit higher at points back at Road America. The 4GT of Glacier Racing, currently being driven by, I think, what we'd consider their frontman, Alexia Loma. Enzo Benito running fifth in the Team Redline car, and can't quite see if he's done a lap yet to let you know how that damage is affecting him, although we don't think too much. Sixth position, Inex Racing Blue, so two cars inside the top six for Inex at the moment. Jack Sedgwick driving that one. Seventh position is the roof of Virgil Racing, Anders Dahl at the wheel there. In eighth position is Radicals Online 2 with Vincenzo Amico driving. Ninth is JCL Sim Racing and Team Camara 2 very close behind in 10th with Ben Tusting at the wheel. 11th position is Iberica Racing Team, who were on somewhat of a chargeback after a number of penalties earlier in the race, with Pablo Lopez driving that roof around at quite some pace at the moment. 12th position, R4R Motorsport, another quiet one today, but doing very well to run in such a strong position. Currently Sam Michaels driving there. In 13th position is Pure Racing Team 2. Right behind them is Flux Racing Team running in the 14th position. And rounding out our current top 15 positions is Pure Racing Team 1, the number 7 McLaren, currently being driven by Andreas Olmensberger.
Yeah, just a note of people outside the top 15. Vortex Sim Racing currently running 17th. Joel Gez behind the wheel. We have AB Racing Black, I believe we saw in the top 10 earlier with some pits during pit stops. They're currently running 19th. Infinity Esports 22nd. Team TTL 24th. Team Camaro 1 all the way back in 27th. I say all the way back, but that's not even halfway through the field. let's see, Trinity Motorsports, their number one car is currently in 32nd position. GT Roast Orange, all the way back in 47th, possibly had another incident. Unfortunately for them, that their roofs were extremely quick. However, things happen sometimes.
Yeah, confirmed retirements as well, just to quickly run through them. Falcon GP, New World SimSport 2, Direct Clutch Motorsport, Rincon Racing, USC SR Team Frenzy, and was it Velocidaddy as well who couldn't make the start? Looks like another team that may have retired is Trinity Motorsports 3, but I can't get fully confirmed on that one.
I just want to go ahead and say that McLaren is just fine.
Yeah, did an 18-1 or something in their first lap.
Yeah, I think they got either really lucky with the repair. I mean, they were there for a long time. I think they've lost almost two laps.
Could they maybe have lost a lot of time from the actual towing itself and still had a fast repair?
You know, I'm not really sure. I know they used one fast repair for sure, but other than that, I never saw the car get any damage whatsoever. So maybe they somehow still got lucky and had a faster fast tow left. If so, they definitely just got rid of it. So they for sure don't have any more remaining.
So no more pirouetting into walls at the top of Eau Rouge.
Yeah.
For Team Redline if they want to carry on in a good position.
This is definitely their mulligan here, and they got to kind of watch out for that. Anders Dahl also, just wanted to note, is catching NX Racing Blue, Virgil Racing, Anders Dahl. Yeah. Just want to note that Enzo is trying to beat his fastest lap, not succeeding, 17.8 versus 17.7. Sounds like just got word that Trinity Motorsport just had an incident. I guess it would be the number 60 car for them, their first car. Don't actually have a good description right now. Just sounding like they were letting cars by and then, oh sorry, the number 62 is the Trinity Motorsports 3. They were letting cars by and then, I don't know if the driver lost concentration or not, but he got on the grass and then crashed. So pretty unfortunate for them. I'm actually trying to see now which battle is going to happen first. Is Enzo going to catch Glacier Racing in the Ford GT, or is Anders Dahl going to catch NX Racing Blue's BMW?
I think they both just dipped to being within a second of each other.
I do know that Enzo is on completely fresh new tires, whereas Alexi Aloma is about to pit any lap. So, yes, that is why you see Enzo flying in comparison. Wow, 4.5 seconds last lap alone.
Yeah,
oh, and you see a spin just in front. Sorry about that. Looks like Pure Racing Team 3. Their BMW just did a nice little 360 right in front. Enzo probably now wanting to pass the Glacier Racing car down the Kimmel Straight after Eau Rouge.
Passing that Ford GT in a straight line hasn't been something that many people have managed to pull off. It's a very quick car.
Yeah, I realized that after I said it, but I think that Alexi will be nice. Oh, never mind. Well, I say that to be fair, Enzo wasn't close enough yet to really make a difference. On board now with Enzo Benito.
No,
you see that Glacier Racing car
enough.
Fighting for grip there. The tires play a huge role in these cars, 2 seconds apart. That's simply just tires doing that.
You can see as well that Enzo doesn't want to make a brash move of it. He certainly doesn't want to damage his car at the moment, but he also doesn't want to go damaging theirs.
Yeah, I think now Team Redline for sure have to drive a more conservative manner and just hope that teams ahead of them make mistakes as well.
I'm not sure that Enzo understands conservative manner.
I don't know, look at it. He's very, very calm right now, even
he
though he's getting held up massively. Ooh. He's looking. Yep, he's going to try to make a pass before Blanchimont. Alexi Aloma, very smart, decided to lift before the corner, allowing both of them to take the corner at a more level pace. I believe we'll see Alexi Aloma pit this time or not. I was lied to. Now that we saw that pass for position, we're going to fall back to Anders Dahl. I'm going to stay on board, however. Fall back to Anders. Oh, and we see NX Racing Blue. Jack Sedgwick just pit.
So that resolves that battle as well, I guess.
Oh, but we found another.
Oh.
Pure Racing Team 2 currently right on the back of R4R Motorsport. Going to go up the inside, down the Kimmel Straight. Sam Michaels looks like he's going to give Noah Lundberg the position.
Ben Tusting's getting very, very close to Thibault Vernisse as well, so the battle for 9th and 10th between Camara. Oh, in fact, that move's
yes.
Just been made.
Yeah, JCL Sim Racing just entered the pits, allowing Team Camara 2 to overtake them. Of the NX Racing Blue car that we mentioned before, they have done their pit stop, I believe, or at least close to finishing it. Simon can tell now at the wheel. Simon's been changing his sleeping schedule, so we'll probably see him driving in the car for different times out of the next 5 hours or so. Maybe even later than that. As
those are hideously obtuse times for someone to be running in the UK.
Yeah, he's kind of switched up his sleeping schedule lately. And basically the past 3 days or so made it to... Oh! Wow. Well, I guess we're glad that cars are sort of invisible in iRacing when in the pits. Next Racing Red also pit, and Laurent replaces Jake Sturgis in the car.
So just going through another pit window at the moment, it would appear most of the teams have started or have already made their way down pit lane. No doubt a few more to follow in the coming laps. Of course, there'll be a few people out of schedule now. I think probably you'd count Enzo Benito and Team Redline as being a little off schedule, and obviously the Coanda Simsport car off schedule with everyone else as well.
Yeah, oddly enough, even though Team Redline car was in the pits and whatnot, somehow it says live timing is reporting that there was never a pit stop. So obviously that is inaccurate. And therefore, well, yeah, they're not really 23 laps into a stint currently. They're much, much less than that. I don't know the exact number now, unfortunately. Oh, and actually Enzo just ran wide. Used to so many mistakes by these guys on the 12-hour race. I mean, they wouldn't even have reached 12 hours yet. They've seen quite a few mistakes. Sometimes I believe the pressure of a 24-hour race, them thinking how they have to stay calm for 24 hours, I think that actually gets the best of them. Kind of lose focus on what's directly ahead of them. So see a battle for position here. This is All-Star Racing Team 3 versus 8 or 80. All-Star Racing Team has about 3 laps on their tires versus 8 or 80's 23 laps. And you see it as they make that look pretty easy there. See, 8 or 80's just been cruising this lap. Some of the teams from 30th on back kind of just cruising along. Obviously not all drivers are going to be driving 150% like others in the I would say top 10 or so. currently have a battle between the KRT, KRT Motorsport 2 car, and the Vortex Sim Racing car, as they're trying to maneuver around the Mad Cow. Actually, Mad Cow car is in front of them on track, about a lap ahead. Just saw Vortex Sim Racing passing. KRT Motorsport 2.
This is another thing that you do see quite often in endurance racing, is people who maybe are about ahead through consistency come under attack from those guys 3-4 laps down who have had big incidents but are running much quicker on the track.
Yeah, we saw something like that earlier where NX Racing Red was leading the race, but then Virgil Racing came out of the pits and they were kind of, catching. And instead of passing, they kind of just, waited and stayed, nice and patient until NX Racing Red pit, and then they went on their merry way. And not all teams are going to be like that, but, some are.
True. There's no obligation in those situations to certainly be friendly. I mean, if you're faster, then you could take the position. But, of course, if you're the car on the lap down and then you cause an accident, it's going to look a lot worse for you if that does happen.
We're gonna have Sam Michaels, I believe, he's still in the pits. He's about to exit the pits. Quite a few cars making their pit stops. I believe I just saw the Radicals Online 2 car, yes. Vincenzo Amico, just pit. Anthony Roselli coming in. Anthony, an American, so it kind of makes sense now that he's doing US primetime stints.
So, you're obviously pretty well linked with the NX guys, and I understand that you don't really have any drivers over in the sort of Australian time zone, so obviously Simon's been altering his sleeping pattern, but have you had to do the same with the other team, just find someone willing to run the ridiculous stints?
So, NX Racing Red, we have, Lawrence doing a stint right now, I believe it's 1:30 in France? That's how far he's gone. I don't know if he's doing a stint after this. I actually don't know their stint plan hardly at all. We've actually haven't really, it's kind of funny. I don't tell them any admin stuff. They don't tell me any of their racing stuff. So that's how it's kind of been every single race week so far this season. Only thing I know is basically how long the stints are and whatnot. So that's about it. But I believe that, Simon's doing the late night for NX Racing Blue. NX Racing Red, they have Jake and PJ. So those are the Americans. However, I don't know if both of them are going to stay up late. The reason I say this is they're both at the same computer and therefore, or not same computer, sorry, in the same house. And therefore, if their power goes out, their internet goes out, something like that, it can affect both of them. So what I think, they're doing is they're going to split that up. Dave, who I believe is going to be racing for NX Racing Red, Dave Valink, he hasn't currently driven yet. So I'm assuming that him and probably PJ are going to be doing the night stints. Jake probably has gone to sleep, so is Isaac. Jake hasn't gone asleep yet, but Isaac has for sure. And they will be back in the morning. Isaac, being from the UK, going to be back much earlier.
Yes, as hopefully I should be, but I reckon.
Yep.
I've told Deco to message me on Facebook when you want me awake, because my phone will be on and I'll be able to hear it. So.
Yeah, just tell us when you go to sleep and we'll start messaging you then.
From 1 a.m. UK time until whenever I bother turning up, basically.
Yes.
That'll be lovely. I'll really enjoy that. I've had one of those days where I've not slept properly anyway, so.
Yay. Well, at least you get to sleep.
True, true. Okay, I'm very happy that it's you that does the admining and the stuff like that, as opposed to me. Just put it that way.
So, I just wanted to take a shout out to our very bright admin, Michael Booth, who went against my, I guess you could say, advice, and decided to try to save the replay after over 8 hours into the race. And currently, he's been waiting over 2 minutes for it to finish saving.
What a mistake to make.
Yeah, he should have done it either every 4 hours, even every 3 hours. Waiting to 8 hours in, that's
eight
rough.
Eight will be an interesting file size.
Yes.
To say the very least.
And he always says that he has some pretty slow upload speed, so that's fantastic.
So if you're looking for the replays for the first 8 hours of the race, please consult Michael Booth and Phil Diaz in about a week's time.
Yep.
That's roughly when it will be ready.
Currently looking at the GTRS car. I believe these are French drivers as well. Currently hunting down the blue car, BMW. It's Trinity Motorsports. Just got passed by the number 45 New World Sports Scarlett. That car is one lap ahead of both of these. Trinity wasn't really a defensive move or anything like that, just kind of probably just a little word to New World Simsport. Been testing, currently pitting out of the 7th position. Sitting in the pits now for Team Camaro 2.
It seems that as you go through the hours, you do find that the pit stops start spreading out more. Obviously, some teams will probably be running 24, 25 lap stints, and it's 26, 27, and after a number of hours, it does get spread out. So when we do get to these pit windows, it takes quite a bit longer for them to fully filter through. So we did have lots of battles about 10, 15 minutes ago, but it will probably take another 10, 15 minutes for any of those to start forming again.
Yeah, that's kind of what happens here, and it's going to get to a point to where there is no real designated pit. We actually just see the GTRS running worldwide. See if GTRS can get any closer here. It's another battle on track between the All-Star Racing team and AB Racing Black. However, I think, yes, AB Racing Black just had a mistake. Okay, exiting Pujon there. I'm gonna go back and watch and see what happened here. Oh, yeah, just lost it on the exit there. Oh, definitely have damage to the left rear and left front of that car. However, they haven't... I don't think they came into the pits yet. Oh, no, they're running wide here through Blanchimont. The car is definitely damaged. Gonna have to come into the pits. Probably some toe damage here. Yes, you can see on the brakes, this car is wiggling quite a bit.
Yeah, an unfortunate one there, and I think that's the kind of incident that you're going to see between now and probably hour 12, 13. It's where people are tired and fatigued, and you see the mistakes that lead to those kinds of accidents more and more often, and no doubt I'll go to sleep and wake up and there'll have been a complete reshuffle, mostly because of said accidents down to tiredness. So, the first of many, I think, AB Racing right there.
Yeah, people are just, you know, getting a little tired here, and they're bound to make little mistakes. Looks like the Glacier Racing car now in the pits.
As is pure Racing Team 2 by the looks of things.
The Yanni Hagner coming back into the car for Glacier Racing.
Eight and a half hours in, a big shout out to all 473 people currently watching, and the guys in the IRC chat as well. It's been fantastic to have, I guess, people just listening to us. It's always a nice feeling for the commentators, and certainly for the guys that administrate and run this series, to have as many people watching and interested. It must be nice for yourself and Boothy.
That's a good feeling, actually. Good feeling to watch all these drivers also race. Probably, I want to say, probably 400 drivers are going to be racing in this race. Actually, no. Sorry, that was a really off number there. My bad. Probably 300 drivers are going to be in this race.
Apologies. That seems like a reasonable number. Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry, I've been up for close to 12 hours now, and
don't worry, only 15 and a half to go.
Exactly.
Are they going to let you have a rest at any point, Phil?
Oh, no. I don't think so. Once you go, it's just going to be some American time for probably about 5-6 hours.
Yeah, well, myself and no doubt some of the other British commentators will be making ourselves known as early as we wake up, basically. Relieving some of the pressures from yourself and Decker. I presume Boothy will stick around and keep you both posted as well.
Yeah, I hope so. He is admitting after all.
Yeah, speaking of Americans, Jonathan Palmer is back with us in the commentary box.
Yeah, and he has pizza. And he can't even ship it to me, it's too far away.
If you give me the number of your nearest pizza joint, I could always call and pay for you. Have it shipped.
I'm good, because then I gotta get up out of my seat and go to the door and grab it. That's too much time wasted. I'm too dedicated. And here we have a battle here. Don't worry, guys, we haven't missed out this battle. Trinity kind of squeezed GTRS there. They're lapping the Mad Cow racing car. You see, it's definitely a mad cow now. It looks like a cow, and it's mad because it has a lot of damage. So, and its name's Daisy. If you look at the front windscreen.
Yeah, mad cow cars are fantastic to look at.
It's gonna sound terrible, but for the past 30 seconds, I've been trying to get this battery out of this remote, and it looks like the remote might actually be cracked in a way that's why it's not working anymore.
That would be unfortunate for you. I also hear that I missed a really mental Formula E race at some point today as well. Not sure what went on there. You probably didn't see it either if you were commentating. I was off racing at the time, so.
Yeah, we were busy. We heard it happen.
Yeah, I've been avoiding Facebook, so I don't know what.
By the way, first two parts, first 6 hours of the race are on YouTube. YouTube.com looks for Masters of Endurance. Expect the lowest, the first quality. The higher qualities should be ready on YouTube sometime in the overnight.
Don't worry, I almost have this battery out.
You're getting there. I believe that we are still watching on the screen the very close battle, only 4-5 tenths of a second between the number 129 GTRS Azure Roof and the number 30 Trinity Motorsports. The number 60, rather, Trinity Motorsports BMW running in the 30th position. So, a good battle for 29th, one of a few close battles that are going on at the moment. Keeping my eyes on it. Radicals Online 2, Anthony Rosselli very close behind JCL Sim Racing in the battle for 9th position, about a second in it there. And what looks like it might be a three-way battle for 16th between the 70, 79 and 74 cars. That would be Race Walkabout Racing, Phoenix Motorsports 1 and Flux Racing Team respectively.
Currently looking here at JCL Sim Racing and Radicals Online 2. I believe Radicals Online 2 is running around with a black flag right now because they went off, or they have a, they got a slowdown in Eau Rouge, and they said that the driver slowed down to serve it, however, well, hasn't happened. Also want to note that Enzo Benito for Team Redline has crashed.
Again.
This is not good, and I don't think that that would be fixed.
He got basically within the last lap, getting tapped going to Lecombe by Jerviki for Marlboro Motorsports.
Yeah, that's not good. That's a lot of damage there.
And we're pretty sure that they're out of their fast tows. They must be out of their fast tows.
Yeah, so this is...
Well,
this
hopefully
is
not
good for them. It matters how much... I don't know. It just matters how much damage is actually fixed through iRacing. Definitely not a fast tow, as you see the damage is still there, so once he stopped in this pit stall, so I really don't know if iRacing's gonna be able to fix all this or not. Matters if he got a meatball flag. I'm assuming he did not. Actually, no, he probably got a meatball flag, but it probably cleared once he stopped in this pit stall. So tough break once again for Team Redline.
This presumably will be a much lengthier stop than their previous one.
Yes, for sure.
And I'm guessing it's too far gone now for us to get a replay.
Yes, this is over 60 seconds, so I cannot go back for a replay. Now see AB Racing Silver, BMW here on screen. Currently trying to chase down Infinity Esports Peter Ridley. However, I believe Infinity Esports actually overtook them recently. Yes, Infinity Esports just came out of the pits. Fresh tires, so they've overtaken and will presumably drive away. Also, the battle that Oscar mentioned earlier, starting to brew. number 79 of Phoenix Motorsports. If you remember, we did interview one of their drivers. Currently moved all the way up to the 17th position. Actually gonna ride on board here and let you guys enjoy some of the action. Car overtaking there was Team Kimura, number two car. That was a lap ahead of Phoenix Motorsports. Therefore, they respectfully let him by. Unfortunately for Team Redline, Enzo Benito is still sitting in the pits. Had a very, very lengthy pit stop.
Don't know how accurate the live timing is on this one, but it's reading Team Redline as being in 15th at the moment and presumably will fall back further.
Yes, all the way back to 18th right now. Every single lap it's going to drop even more positions. As you can see now, Andre Martins for Phoenix Motorsports. Catching just little by little. Number 70, Race More, Kraut Racing. Gonna do a little premature switch as well. We have Virgil Racing trying to chase down NX Racing Blue. This is for the sixth position. NX Racing Blue about halfway through their stint, while Virgil Racing is six laps into their stint.
If I was better at iRacing, I'd be taking part, I think. This looked like good fun.
Yeah, things are, I would say, quiet. They're definitely not. We actually just, a little bit of contact there between the number 9 of Pure Racing Team 2 and the number 102, I believe that's Mad Cow Racing 2. A little contact there. Pure Racing Team 2 was trying to pass. Going back to the Virgil Racing car. It's a little quiet. However, there's still, you know, little battles for position every now and then. It's always the nighttime. It's always, you know, quiet. People now trying to getting a simple rhythm. Since it started night in Europe, it's well past midnight now. It's almost 1 a.m. in the UK. So over here, it's not even 8 p.m. yet.
Being informed in the IRC chat that Team Redline have got 20 minutes of repairs from that accident.
Oh, man.
That's a really bad number. That'll put them back outside the top 30, outside the top 40.
Yeah, they're already 30th right now.
That'll put them down to about 50th spot, if maybe a bit in front, but sort of 45th to 50th. That's a hideous blow to their day.
Yeah, and we're not even halfway through yet. It's... I haven't seen the replay. I don't know if it was just impatience or a mistake by somebody. But, you know, at this point in time, it's just one of those situations where you have to get in the car and then just try to make the best of it. Things are going to happen. You can gain 10 positions, 15 positions, and just, you know, finish wherever that may be. See Virgil Racing. Diving up the inside of an X-Racing Blue. Simon Cattell not really contesting that. Huge tire difference. Just behind that, we have Radicals Online to have caught up to JCL Sim Racing. Oh, JCL Sim Racing! Huge crash there. Oh, big accident for them. This is in a not so good area. Oh, I have no idea how they're gonna spin around here. A car exiting the pits.
Oh god, that was huge.
Yeah, this is a big accident. And I would watch the replay, however, we saw what happened live. And they're actually gonna take the tow now.
Yep, and just complete overcorrection at the top of the hill.
Yeah, that's now they're gonna have to take a tow all the way around the track, so this is gonna be a long one.
They got all four wheels out into the AstroTurf at the top, and it's just there's no grip out there. So presumably when it grip back up on the track, they're just pointing in the wrong direction and turned into it.
Yeah, ran a little bit too wide there. Very lucky there for Radicals Online 2, Anthony Roselli. Seeing what happened, stayed far left, and yeah. This is a time when people get a little tired. There are still 53 cars running, so it's not like, you know, there's been many mistakes here.
No, coming up to, what would that be, 9 hours in. And really, to have so few retirements, very impressive. You'd expect more, particularly with it being a bit busy at the beginning. You tend to see quite a few retirements in those first sort of 5 to 6 hours compared to maybe the rest of the race. So, good job from them so far to keep it mostly clean.
Yeah, surprisingly, the beginning of every race has been rather clean. We don't see many crashes at all the first 5 laps or so. Maybe just, you know, little bumps here and there, but nothing extreme. Got to thank all the teams for that.
Makes your lives as admins a bit easier, I imagine. Not having to go through incidents for the first 2 hours of the race from lap 1 through 10.
Yeah, that makes it a lot easier. Sorry about that, was stretching out. But yeah, it's it would be painful to have to review a bunch of incidents right at the beginning, but most teams have realized, if not all the teams have realized, you know, these are long races, it's good to be patient. And, you know, whatever you lose in the first hour or so, even the first 10 minutes really, once the field starts, you know, opening up a little bit. You don't have to brake so early for every corner. Then, you know, you can make that up over the course of the race. Team Camaro, their second car, prime example. First round, round one, they spun off after qualifying in the top 10. They spun off at the very beginning, first lap, I believe. Dropped all the way back to 50-something position, and then drove all the way back up into the top 10. So it's definitely possible. Saw a pass for position there. Pure Racing Team 1 just passed Flux Racing Team. Dylan Sharman back in the car now for Team TTL. Assuming he just woke up and realized that his car that was in the top 10, definitely like top 12 or so earlier, is now 28th. He's probably not extremely thrilled about that.
He'll be hoping that in a minute he'll wake up from what would appear to be a bit more of a nightmare than he wanted.
Yes. However, a nice simple pass around the outside. Next car is, I believe, GTRS car. Yes. Number 129, about 18 seconds ahead. So Dylan, you have like 5 laps to catch up.
Yeah. Very different stuff, all this endurance racing. Earlier in the evening I was doing 15 minute touring car races. As you can imagine, a bit more mental than driving a 24-hour endurance event. Everyone just trying to crash into each other.
So joining us in the commentary box now is Mr. Anders Dahl.
Hello.
Straight from Denmark, I see. Or no,
that's... Yeah. It's right.
Okay, I was right there. I'm getting tired already. So how's the race been for you?
I just did my first ever stint in Masters of Endurance, so that's very good. We had stop and go for a slowdown, and then we had a drive-through penalty for a little contact. But we are moving forward, so that's good.
So you guys are up to the fifth position right now. I see the front end damage, I'm assuming, is from the drive-through, whatever the penalty was for, unavoidable contact, I believe. But
exactly.
Is car handling okay?
It feels all right. I think we had some optional repairs, but we didn't take it. And we might have been a little down on straight line speed, but it seems to be better at the moment.
Good. I see you guys are making your way back through the field, basically. I believe you're in fourth at the time of the penalty, so currently in fifth, so you guys are making your way back up.
Yeah, we just saw red line rolling a bit. That's unfortunate for them, but it's one place fast at least.
Yeah, that's actually the second time that's happened in probably an hour, maybe two.
Yeah.
Very, very short amount of time to have two big incidents like that. And this last one, not good for them. I can't even see where they are right. They're in 45th currently.
Yeah, I think they are. I saw Enzo leaving, so yeah. It really a shame.
So obviously a slight up and down so far for Virgil, but you guys really, in terms of iRacing, have been, you know, getting pretty well known for being a bunch of quick blokes when it comes to GT racing. I remember that you were was it when I last competed on a 24-hour race, running very well in 4GT, seems to ring a bell. So, yeah. Like, when you guys as a group prepare for these big 24-hour events, what does most of the practice go into? Because obviously there are points for pole here. Is that something you even think about, or do you focus entirely on the racing, the strategy, and making a setup that works for an hour and 5 minutes at a time, that kind of thing?
When Enzo is racing, there's no going for pole anyway, so that was never our intention. We just wanted to to start as high up as possible, so we avoid problems. But for some reason, our qualifying pace is not that good. But in race, we are always moving forward. So I guess it's only race pace we are, or the race setup we are focusing on. We had a lot of problems with the rear tires, the overheating, and basically the first week we practiced, we were crashing out after 6 laps, and we had no idea how to solve it, but I think we found something that works at the moment.
Yeah, we've seen quite a few of the groups actually have oversteer issues, and recently I think it was AP Racing
Black,
was it? Had a yep. Oversteery moment out of Puan and put their car into people. So a common problem it seems with the roof around Spa, but you guys dealing with it well and running in fifth at the moment. Feasibly, what kind of result do you want to get out of it come the end of the 24 hours?
Well, if we do not have any problems, I would think that third position was within our reach, but that is that would be over our expectation from the beginning. We didn't think that was possible. Top 5 was very good and top 10 was the goal, so we are very happy at the moment.
Just you guys in round 1 were actually extremely competitive. You had a different strategy. You're actually extending your stints out and everything compared to the other teams, possibly saving a pit stop. And you guys had an incident. Were you actually going to be racing in round 1 or was
no,
that...
I wasn't available that day, so I didn't know about that much about that race, but I know that we had the tow bug, and then Stefan tried to push to gain places and crashed out. So, and then at Suzuka we also had the pace. We started 25th again, but and then we got spun around on one of the first laps. So we were down to almost last position, and we finished 9th, I think. That was a very good drive from Marcus and Kimi.
Yeah, it was a very good recovery there. I believe we watched you guys for quite a bit of that coming through the field. Seems that's been a thing with some of the top teams coming, having to come through the field. Coanda had to do it last race as well. Had to do it this race even. So, yeah. Props to you guys for doing that, actually.
Yeah.
So, Anders, you said this is your first MLE race, correct?
It is.
You did partake in Live for Speed events back in the day. I think when I remember seeing you kind of begin, weren't you kind of too new to endurance racing, or at least LFS endurance racing? That's why you were joined in kind of too late for the MLE party and Live for Speed days?
Yeah, I think so. We were doing Grand Touring Amateur League, is that the name? With was the 7-carat team then? It's a very long time ago, I think we did pretty well there. And I don't want to say it's a childhood dream to compete in this event, but you know, it's one of these things as a sim racer that you are going to do the 24-hour of Masters of Endurance.
So what? What kind of really attracted you to MLE when you first discovered it?
I guess it's the best endurance race there's, or at least the highest quality of drivers. To be honest, I'm not really a GT3 driver. I don't enjoy it that much, and I don't have the speed that the other guys do. But still, it's a lot of fun. And even though the practice session is a bit long sometimes, when you're doing the race, it's fantastic. It feels very good.
And looking at your team drivers in this, Wasn't Marcus Johansson and Stefan also in 7 Carat? I think I remember them in.
Yeah, no, they weren't. This is a completely new team. Yeah, there was, I don't know anybody from that team that does iRacing anymore.
I was thinking of familiar from years or some other name.
You mentioned you're not a huge fan of GT3. Now, what if we just made the roof C-spec the car? Would you love that?
I would love it so much. I'm such a fan of that car.
At least you have the roof now. It's just a little bit more powerful, maybe a little bit more downforce.
Yeah, and traction control and ABS and stuff. But
yeah,
I have the I can do the C-spec in the new series, so I get my fix there.
Oh, that's true. Yes. Is this a different aspect where it's single class versus the multi-class? I know not every single team is the exact same pace, but how is it with traffic and whatnot?
I think it's very different. Yeah. When there's a slow car here, I think you have to watch out, as we saw with Enzo. They sometimes do things you do that you don't expect. Or they don't expect us to be that fast at the rear, so it's more of a balance of not accidentally touching someone because they are doing some different things. Where I think that's the multi-class racing we do in EU is you kind of know that the HPGs are just a lot faster than the roofs, so they kind of work their way around.
Anders, website or anything you'd like to plug?
Nah, not really. It's, thanks for doing the event. It's been great fun so far. Hopefully we can keep it up.
Alrighty, Anders Dahl for Virgil Racing. Good luck to you and your team the rest of this race and season.
Thank you.
Thank you and good luck.
So, it is 9 hours gone in the race, and it's about that time to do another pause in the stream action. So while things seem to be extremely quiet, I think we will be able to take care of that right now. So, stay with us. If you're with us tonight, we would love to have you. Feel free to talk to us. We'll give all that information. On the flip side, give it a few seconds. Hopefully we'll be back on the flip side. See you in a second.